Let's get into our top story. The gig may be up for gig economy stocks. Look at shares of Uber, Lyft, and DoorDash right now. They are sinking on the back of a new proposal from the Biden Labor Department that could pave the way for gig workers to reclassify as employees instead of as independent contractors. The proposals still need to go through a formal regulatory process, including time for the public to submit comments. In a statement to CNBC, Uber's head of federal affairs says it is, quote, crucial that the Biden administration continues to hear from the 50 million people who have found an earning opportunity with companies like ours. Both Lyft and DoorDash say they are not anticipating any changes to their business, and the rule will not reclassify workers as employees. Joining us now is Bradley Tusk from Tusk Ventures. He was an early investor in Uber, a former political consultant for the company. This is right in your wheelhouse at the intersection of tech and regulatory issues. You've advocated in the past that these companies should classify their workers as employees. So do you applaud this move by the Biden administration?
I don't want to applaud either side of it, because I think that we're in a world where we have a structure that was developed in the 1930s, where we had W-2 on one side and 1099 on the other, and everyone, for their own economic interests, is pushing the world as if we're still living in 1936. So if you're the unions, what do you really want? You want more members, you want more dues. You can only get that if people become W-2 full-time workers, so that's why they're pushing that. That's why the Biden administration issued this rule. If you are the platforms, what do you want? You want the lowest operating cost possible, so you want everyone as an independent contractor. The reality is we live in a world where the sharing economy is a new way to work, and there's no reason we can't come up with a world that's a little more thoughtful, it's a little more policy work involved. But to say these are basic protections that workers should have, disability, workers' comp, whatever it is, and yet they still deserve the flexibility to choose their own kind of work and make their own schedules. And the lack of this not happening is not because it's bad policymaking. It's just because everyone is completely focused on politics and their bottom line.
How about the market reaction, Bradley? We're seeing a pretty sharp sell-off. Even though some of the analysts, I was reading a KeyBank research report saying this is totally overdone, and even if these go through, it's less than 5% of Uber and Lyft's workforce that actually work more than 40 hours a week and would see higher costs from the company.
Right. So you're not looking at a 20 to 30% increase in operating costs like Uber and Lyft and DoorDash, I understand. It's clearly going to be a lot lower than that. At the same time, I think that you have a world where we have to worry about, in a tight labor market, is the supply of workers still going to be there for an Uber, for a Lyft, for a DoorDash, for an Instacart? All of a sudden, the workers have to say, this is not my full-time job, and I have to pay union dues, and I have to only work here and nowhere else. And so I think if you're the platforms, you're concerned, one, about increased operating costs, but you're also just concerned about an already tight worker market becoming even tighter, not having enough drivers to do the work.
So do you think they're going to eat those higher costs ultimately, or where consumers are going to pay those higher costs because they can just pass them off?
Of course, we're going to pay those higher costs. That's always the case. And look, you've got a world right now where the workers are in the driver's seat. That might change as inflation continues to go up and interest rates go up. But right now, I think ShiftSmart's latest data said that for every four jobs available for a gig economy worker, they accepted one of them. So right now, the companies are in need, and they will absorb the cost. But long term, like they always do, regulatory cost, despite what I think many of the left seem to think, doesn't get absorbed by the stock market or by the Fortune 500 or by the companies. It gets absorbed by the consumers. And so every time you put a new cost, a new burden on a company, you're just taxing your own consumers that much more.
Well, I guess they do have to pay more in lobbying. So Bradley, how would you approach gig economy stocks, public stocks, private companies, which I know you're focused on in your venture fund? Yeah. Would you rethink it, given that there is a potential change here to their business model and their economy?
It would really depend on the company, right? So there are some companies that are heavily dependent on people who really do work 50, 60 hours a week at that one platform. It seems that they're going to be classified as W-2, so you have to refactor that into the math as to whether or not the deal makes sense. There are other companies, though, where people are working on average, take Handy, for example, which is on your list there, 15 hours a week. Whatever investment you may want to make or not make in Handy shouldn't really be dictated by the concern about this new federal law, because it's not going to really affect them.